Markers can be quite daunting to work with, especially because of their high price. So in today's video, I want to take a look at the basics and also some advanced topics of working with them. I'll be using copied markers almost throughout the video, but most of what I'll be showing you also applies to alcohol-based markers from other brands, and I'll get into some of the differences between them as well. When I first started drawing in 2005, Copics were the first medium I colored my work with. Back then, I was only aware of two brands of alcohol-based markers, Copics and Pro Markers. Their main difference were the nibs. While Pro Markers had hard nibs, Copic offered markers with the famous brush nib that made them more suitable for manga illustration. Why and how that is, I'll show you in this video. It's 2018 and the market has expanded to many more brands that make alcohol-based markers. I've gathered a few of them to demonstrate the differences you should keep an eye on. First up, we've got Pro Markers by Vincent Newton, which come in 148 colors. They are comparably cheap, but only have hard nibs. The color labels on the caps accurately represent the color you expect the marker to produce. Their relatives are the brush markers, which are available in 72 colors. These come with brush nibs, which makes them more suitable for me personally. In other aspects, you can expect them to perform similarly to the Pro markers, and according to their website, they are the same price. Graphmaster offers you 124 colors and are cheaper than Pro and brush markers. They also come with hard nibs only, and the color labels on the marker caps can be inaccurate from marker to marker. Here I always advise to test them on a different sheet of paper before using them. Art and Fly markers are similarly affordable and come in 48 colors, which is fairly limited. These also feature brush nibs. However, they have similar discrepancies between color labels and the actual color they produce. Last but not least, Copic markers, of which we will be focusing on the Chao line. Copic sketch are pretty much the same, but bigger and therefore more expensive. And as most of you know, Copics in general are incredibly expensive. While there are 180 color variations for Chao, with sketch you have a choice from 358 colors. Both Chao and Sketch come with brush nibs, and their labels always have been accurate in my experience. There are many more kinds of Copic markers and accessories though, one of which is the airbrush system. I'll show you what that looks like as a bonus at the end of the video. Some brands offer more or fewer colors, so it's not a guarantee that your favorite brand will have every tone you need. In those cases, you'll need to achieve those tones on your own. In addition, there's the colorless blender. These markers contain the fluid but no color pigments. While their purpose might not be immediately obvious, they are quite useful for some specific techniques. We'll take a look at some of these later in the video. All of these markers work with alcohol-based ink, which of course will run out with use. But that doesn't always mean you have to buy completely new ones. With Copics, you can buy color ink refills and refill them quite easily. Some of the other brands are also refillable, even if their manufacturer doesn't make official statements about that or produce refillers. Vincent Newton, for example, make no mention of their Pro markers being refillable on their website. If you attempt such a refill, you'll be doing it at your own risk. The ability of refilling your markers also lets you experiment with mixing different tones to create your own shades. For that purpose, you can buy empty markers so you don't need to use up another one before experimenting. I often buy darker shades and mix them with a clear blender to lighten them up. Speaking of the clear blender, and this might be controversial for some, you can save some money by using Copic cleaner fluid instead. I've heard of people having problems with their markers after doing that, but I've personally never experienced any failures or performance loss by using the cleaner instead of the dedicated blender fluid for mixing colors. Again, use this tip at your own risk, but it may be worth a try. If you're a regular subscriber to my channel, you know one thing for certain. The fact that I use regular office paper for my markers. But that hasn't always been the case, so let me explain why I do it. Included with my first 12 markers back in 2005 was a marker pad. So I thought, if they include manufacturer-specific paper, it must be the proper paper to use with markers. And it does have different properties compared to regular paper. The paper is coated to prevent the color from bleeding through. That also saves you ink, because the paper won't suck your markers dry as quickly. That definitely sounds like a great feature, but the coding has its downsides apart from the higher price. There's only a certain amount of color the paper can take, and that makes layering pretty difficult, if that's what you're going for. If it's just one or two layers, you'll be fine, but it doesn't really work for rendering, where you'll be going over the same areas many, many times with the different colors. At some point, you'll only be dragging and pushing the colors around, as they can't settle on the paper anymore, and might even bleed through anyway. Non-coated paper will absorb your colors like a sponge, so you won't run into that layering problem, or it just occurs after a way higher number of layers. This is an obvious downside that coated paper tries to prevent. Copics are already expensive, and using regular paper will use them up more quickly. That alone might make you stick with coated paper, and I can completely understand. However, if smooth transitions using many layers are important to you, regular paper will give you an easier time because the color will bleed more. Controlling that bleed properly is one of the advanced techniques that is well worth learning. Another aspect where regular paper gives you more flexibility is strength or weight. Marker paper is usually pretty thin, which can be great for tracing your outlines. But some situations simply call for more robust paper, layering being one of them, or combining markers with watercolors. In case you want to combine them with watercolors, make sure to apply the marker only after you are done with the watercolor. The other way around, layering watercolor on Copics that is, sets the watercolor and creates irremovable blotches where the Copic ink is. It just doesn't really work. Speaking of tracing your line art, if you are going to color using Copics, you probably don't want to use pencil line arts, as pencil tends to smudge easily. It's better to go for marker-proof liners. Copic offers their own line of Copic multiliners that even come in different colors, but as you can imagine, there are cheaper alternatives that work just as well. Those are also my preferred choice. Using those liners won't shield you from smudging your line art completely though. In my experience, there are two reasons for that. First reason might be not fully erase pencil lines. After drawing the line art with your marker-proof liner, you'd naturally erase the pencil sketch underneath. But you need to make sure to actually erase all of it, because whatever residue is left might be the cause of the smudging. A trick to be sure to prevent that from happening, use some Copic Blender and carefully dab it on your line art. The dabbing of the clear ink sets the pencil lines, and when it has dried, it won't smudge. This way you can even color a pencil line art if you work carefully and forget the liner completely. The second reason for why your line art smudges, well, actually I have no idea. Maybe the line art wasn't really dry yet, or it was just bad luck. It just happens sometimes. The only consistent solution I've found is using a print of your line art, because the inkjet printer ink isn't waterproof, but Copic proof. If you do your line art digitally, you'll go through this step anyway. With all of that in mind, let's talk about blending. Markers are somewhat versatile. Usually the safest way is to work from light to dark with them, and that is what you'll do most of the time. First up, to blend color perfectly, you need to have colors around the same value. For example, it is possible to blend a light gray with a light purple, or you can blend a light gray with a slightly darker gray. However, it is much harder to blend a light gray with a black tone, or even just a very dark gray. Still, within these color ranges you can blend any color, but you'll need to work on transition tones first. So let's say you want to mix this light purple with the dark green. Then you have to first blend down the purple to a dark purple, and from that you can continue with the dark green. As I said, markers are versatile, the best proof of that is the blender. While you will regularly work from light to dark, with enough ink and pressure you can lighten up smaller areas of your work, and therefore go from dark to light. Now that we've talked about the techniques, let's put them to work. When I start with coloring my drawing, I usually start with the face. Because with this first step we are going from light to dark, I use E50 as my main color and apply a first layer of that tone. E50 is the lightest tone we are going to use, and blend all the other colors with. So in this first step, I already slightly shade the face with wiping motions, using more pressure on the darker parts and only slightly touching the paper where they are going to be the highlights. The highlights in this picture will be around his eyes and cheeks mainly. Then I use E00 for the cast shadow, applying it under the eyebrows, along the nasal bridge and under the nose. I also use this tone for the soft shadows around his face and under his cheeks. Carefully I apply the color and then blend it out with the base tone E15. For the soft look, make sure to use wiping motions and avoid uneven drying of the area. You want the colors to blend into each other without creating edges, and for that the color either needs to still be wet or you carefully wipe color in with a brush nip. But a combination of both is even better. That is why the hard nibs are extremely difficult to use for illustrations like these, as I said in the beginning. As long as the paper is still wet, you also still have the chance to lighten up areas with the colorless blender. If you press the marker on the paper too strongly though, there is a high risk of creating a little sinkhole, so be sure to apply it very softly. So I repeat adding shadows with E00, deepening them and blending them with E50, and once I am satisfied, I add a light purple to the shadows, which is V000. This gives the skin a more natural look and mutes the yellow tone a bit. Any further work on the shadows will be done with pencils, but we will get to that. Now everywhere I painted over the lines, I used the blender to slightly push the color back in line. It doesn't remove all the color, but might make them more subtle. I don't care too much if some color crosses the line, if a darker color will cover those areas later anyway. Next, I continue with the ears and the neck. I do it basically the same way I painted the face. Using E50 as my main color and adding darker layers of color with E00 and V000 for the shadows, blending them with E50. For the hand, or the fingers to be more precise, I start by using a first coat of the blender. Since the fingers in particular are very thin, there is not much room for that swiping motion. I use the blender first so the E50 I place on the edges can bleed into the center and thus create a highlight there. I can soften it by applying more color very lightly. Using this method, I work my way down all the fingers. Because the hand is a large area, it is hard to work as wet as I did on the face. There is a high chance that the color of one finger might dry and create edges while you shade the other one. So I always use less pressure when I come near the back of the hand. This way it's not that hard to create a smooth transition by overpainting and connecting everything when all the fingers are done to create a homogeneous look. When this first layer has dried, I continue adding shadows with E00 again, blending them with E50. I recommend using the wiping motion especially for this part. Otherwise, you might quickly end up with the cell shading look. But of course, it's also fine if that is what you're going for. But for this technique, it's basically just swiping, reactivating paint and blending. Last but not least, using the same method as earlier, I also add the purple V000 shade here as well, to keep everything consistent. Now it's time for the pencils. Pencils are exceptional in combination with markers, as you can add shadows and highlights and even different tones without the risk of ruining your drawing. I use a white pencil to lighten up parts under the eyes and on the nasal bridge. Then I use a flesh tone pencil to deepen the cast shadow and basically add definition here and there, blending parts that I feel could need it. As you can see, the pencil is a bit more pinkish than the Copic tones I used before, and it makes the skin a lot more interesting to look at. For the eyes, I start with C1 and a blender. I use C1 and add a few strokes underneath the upper lash line to create a shadow for the white of the eye and blend it out with the blender. Because C1 is a light tone and the iris is going to be darker, it doesn't really matter if you paint over the iris. Then I add a bit of V000 to match the tones with the rest. For the iris, I start by placing a combination of R00 and R11 on the bottom part of the eye, adding a bit of Y21 in the center to create a more fiery look. We are going to work from light to dark again, so this will work as the highlight, which we will overpaint on certain parts. For that I use R35 and cover the pupil as well as the inner outlines of the iris, so it almost looks like a tiny Pokeball. To blend the area around the pupil, I use R11 together with R35. As the darkest marker tone, I use R59 and draw the pupil in. I also add deeper shadows underneath the upper lash line. For the last details, I use some lighter markers again to strengthen the highlights, as well as using some pencils to add more contrast. In the final step, I use white ink to make the eyes sparkle. For the tongue, I use R11 as a base, adding highlights with the blender by pushing it in the wet color and adding shadows with V91. For the hair, we are going to use the dark to light method a lot, so this might be a bit too much if you are just beginning to use markers. But I think it looks quite interesting, so I wanted to include it in this tutorial as well. To start, we need a dark solid base tone, which is going to be V15. Because the area is quite large, I use the blender to make the color spread a bit easier. Once that is done, I press the blender, then R11 and then B00 on the center of one hair strand, basically pushing away the violet and adding subtle red and blue tones. This creates a bit of a rainbow look. I do this strand by strand. You can actually see what I talked about when I said that ordinary office paper would take a lot of ink. The colors really bleed on the paper and thus blending into each other beautifully. The darker violet that has been pushed away now might look a bit messy, but it creates the base for us to work on the shadows. So with C3, a light gray marker, I go in and define the single hair strands. I use a light color in order to still have the option for changes. For the parts that I'm already pretty sure about, I use the darker BV23 and blend it with the C3. This way I build the hair step by step and give it more definition, using the purple edges from earlier as reference points. Every once in a while I add more of the light red and blue shades to make sure they still stay visible, despite the gray shades. Then to make the highlights pop even more, I use a darker bluish violet and mainly shade the outer edges of the hair area, leaving the center untouched. After that, blending with C3 and darker grays continues until everything looks consistent. Again, you can use pencils to darken, lighten up or blend areas. Now the main parts are done. We can focus on the rest, but that essentially works the same way as I explained before. So I think by now you got the idea. So I will tune out now and will be back with the bonus after the piece is finished. And here comes the little bonus section. The Copic Airbrush system isn't really a tool for Copic beginners, I would assume. But I still wanted to include it here, because I think not that many people know about its existence. When I say it's not a tool for beginners, I don't mean it's difficult to use. It's just quite pricey, and that means something when we are talking about markers in this video. So in order to use it, you would either A. need to buy a compressor, which is really expensive, like the markers weren't enough, or B. you need to buy cans with compressed air, which are also expensive when you have to buy new ones every time you run out of air. Either way, you would need the air grip, that little plastic thing that you put your markers in. Unfortunately, the air grip was made for Copic Sketch, and since I don't own any, I used a bit of clay to fit the chows in. To get ready to use the airbrush on your drawing, you first need to prepare your work. That means cutting a piece of masking film to fit your drawing and carefully using a crafting knife to cut around the outer lines of your work. You end up with a mask that covers everything you want to stay untouched by the airbrush. Place it fittingly on your work and you are good to go. How you use the airbrush is up to you. From now on, it's just basically pressing down the handle of the air grip to regulate the intensity and changing the markers to adjust the colors. Just a few color accents often already look nice. So this is the airbrush system. The use is quite simple, but it's still incredibly expensive. I luckily got this stuff comparably cheap years ago, but thinking about how rarely I have used it, I really recommend thinking twice about it. If you have made similar experiences or different ones regarding any topic I talked about in this video, may it be paper choice, marker alternatives or blending styles, let me know in the comments. This video is sponsored by Skillshare. Skillshare is an online learning community with thousands of classes in art, design, drawing and painting, and many more. An annual subscription is less than $10 a month, and if you are among the first 500 people to sign up using the link in the video description, you'll even get 2 months for free. A premium membership gives you unlimited access to high-quality classes from experts in their fields. For example, I learned several ways of bookmining through multiple Skillshare classes. If you want to learn something, you'll very likely find a class for it on Skillshare. But it also works the other way around. Sometimes you just want to take a peek into a new skill or hobby. Just browse the many classes on the platform and I'm sure you'll find something that piques your interest. It's a valuable resource of courses that can often take you deeper into a topic than many disconnected tutorial videos can. Phew, that was quite a journey. Thank you for staying with me so long. I know this video was quite longer than I expected. If you are interested in more videos like this, more tutorials or speed paints, make sure to subscribe to the channel and hit the bell to get notifications whenever a new video is up. Thank you very much for watching and I hope to see you next time.